Welcome to another episode of the AI Show, where we're going to look at how to actually code up what we saw last week with the music generation with AI. So why don't you tell us, give us a little refresher, so to speak.
Sure. So last time we went over this entire system where we're looking at MIDI and then we're converting it to piano rolls. We're passing it through our sequence-to-sequence model, getting it back to piano roll, and getting music. Mm-hmm. We looked at the model, which was a sequence-to-sequence model with an encoder and decoder. And today we're going to look at what's the code behind this and how this is actually happening.
Fantastic. So let's go look at that.
So let's look at the code for a bit. So this is where all the janitorial work is happening.
It feels like a lot of code. What's actually happening here?
It is a lot of code. So this, basically what it is doing is it's only taking the MIDI files and creating matrices that it can feed to the neural network.
I see. So it's getting raw MIDI input files and converting them to, like, I wish you had a picture
the 2D matrices.
Okay.
So remember we talked about these ones and zeros? It is converting it to these ones and zeros.
I see.
But it's not the model code is not in this file that we're looking at.
I see.
So here is only the conversion of the MIDI files to these ones and zeros.
I see. And so how many, like, when you're doing this, you're just taking a bunch of files, lining them up, and then creating, like, I'm trying to understand what the X and the Y is. I feel like there's a picture that can help me.
Yes. Let me show you that. So this is basically what is happening.
Okay.
So we have a bunch of MIDI files, 156 in this case. We convert them to these piano rolls with the math that we had talked about last time. Mm-hmm. We convert it to a 2D matrix of the notes versus the time. Once we have that, we use a sliding window where the X sequence length is the sliding window that is fed to the encoder, and the Y sequence length is the window that is fed to the decoder.
And just as a reminder, just for me, we were using this because it was stored as ticks inside of the MIDI file. We need to do some math conversion to do it with time. Then we can create a window. And then what you're doing is the X is a sequence of notes over time, and the Y is a sequence of notes after the X sequence of notes.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay. That's awesome. So what does that code look like?
Okay, so let's look at the code. So we have the MIDI to piano roll, which is converting the ticks to the seconds. Mm-hmm. Then we have the create the sequence net inputs, which is taking these two sliding windows, the X sequence length and the Y sequence length, and basically sliding over this piano roll to create your X and your Y for your LSTM.
So this isn't machine learning. This is a lot of
Correct.
Like busy work.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay. So once you get that all out, there it is. If you scroll up, I can see there's like an X1 and a Y1, and it's going to spit that out for the LSTM.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. And so we have a little more work for the sequence test net inputs. We have the net out to the piano roll. So this is what we had talked about, where once the neural network, what the neural network is outputting is a bunch of probabilities, but we need to convert them into ones and zeros. So we set some threshold to determine what probability means a note on or a note off.
So is this for when, so the beginning part was, let's convert it into what the model can understand. This part is, let's convert it into what the model puts out into a MIDI file.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
Great. And then once you have that, you want to convert the piano roll to the MIDI. Mm-hmm. So once you have your ones and zeros from your model, basically what you're telling the model or what you're telling your code is that if it is a one, then you write a note on event. And if it's a zero, then you write a note off event.
Okay, so let's scroll up here because I think we went over something kind of fast for me up here. So set net out to piano roll threshold. Is the LSTM outputting probabilities?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. And so that's why you're doing that.
Right. So you have the probabilities and you need, so if the probability outputted by the model is say 0.3, does that mean an on or an off? So you can decide that with the threshold here.
I see. And the sort of the higher the threshold, the less notes that will come out of the song, et cetera.
Exactly.
Okay, cool.
Exactly.
Okay, that makes sense. And then this thing here converts the Y outputs into the actual MIDI once you've set the threshold and it's not snapped to one or a zero.
Right.
Okay.
Right. And so this will actually, yes. And we had looked at MIDI, which is a sequence of events. These are basically writing those events to a file.
I see. So this is like cleaning up everything to get ready to do machine learning. It's not even the machine learning part.
Correct.
Okay, so when we're training it, can we look at the model file now?
Yes. So to look at the model file, we have the model defined here. I am using Keras. Mm-hmm. And basically what I have defined here is an encoder and a decoder structure. So we start with a sequential layer. You add your LSTM. We are doing batch normalization and dropout. This is then fed to the decoder, which is also consists of the LSTM, batch normalization, and dropout.
I see. And so what I understand machine learning is you have this really huge function. You have this loss function or the cost function, and you're just trying to optimize with respect to the parameters over the loss function. Is that right?
Correct.
So what optimizer are you using?
So the loss function here that I'm using is the categorical cross entropy loss.
Okay.
Because it is a multi-label classification problem.
I see. And then are you using some kind of gradient descent or?
Yes, I'm using the Adam optimizer.
Oh, okay.
So it's one of the optimizers that you get built in within Keras.
Fantastic. And as I'm looking at the code, it's like the machine learning part is actually not very hard, right?
Yep. It's just 10 lines, a little more than that.
That's cool. And so the thing that I fear is that when people look at all the other code, they're like, oh, I can't write that. But really, that's not hard.
Right.
And obviously, the machine learning part is hard. And once you understand it, you can write these things as well, which is super nice.
Right.
All right. Exactly. So how do we go about training it?
OK. So for that, we are going to use extension mm-hmm. as part of this editor. So I'm using Visual Studio Code. I can run it through the terminal here. Uh-huh. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to open the Azure Machine Learning terminal.
Okay.
And I'm going to submit an experiment to train this model.
Okay.
So that's an easy ML experiment. Submit -C. I have a remote compute target, which we will talk about. And then it's going to start training.
So it looks like you like to type things, but my understanding is you can also right-click on MySDVM, set up a job setup, and then it will do that as well. But you like typing stuff.
I do like typing stuff. But yes, you can go to MyDSVM and submit the job if you have configured it in the VS Code section here.
I see. That makes perfect sense. And so let's talk about, because this is going to take a while, and so we have some time to talk, let's talk a little bit about like what is this MyDSVM, and then what is this talking about?
Right. Good point. Right. So what's happening behind the scenes is this. So you have your code, foo.py. In our case, it's train.py. We set up a remote target. In this case, it's your DSVM and with a Docker container. And I've set up my compute target with my credentials for my DSVM. I've set up my run config to tell it that I'm executing Python code. I have all my dependencies in my conda dependencies.yml file. Mm-hmm. So the Python MIDI libraries or TensorFlow or Keras, whatever I want, is all defined here. They need to be pip installable. And then what the Azure ML Experimentation Service is doing is it submits a job which is on a remote VM through a Docker container.
And that's what the MyDSVM thing was.
Exactly.
Okay.
So MyDSVM is the remote VM.
So let's pause right here. For conda dependencies, this is just saying, here's all the things I need. So effectively, all the pip install stuff.
Exactly.
Okay. And then the user Python, that makes sense. My remote VM compute is the definition of your remote machine. Is that right?
It is the definition of my remote machine, and it is telling Azure ML what is the base Docker image.
I see.
And it is telling it what is the credential. So what is the IP address of your DSVM, what are the credentials, and what is the type.
I see. And the my remote VM config, what is that? That's telling it how to run it.
So yeah, in the run config, you can set a bunch of things. One of them is like environment variables. So if you want to, link it to your cloud storage and stuff, you can link it there.
So that makes sense. So you have the thing you're running, you have the environment where it's running, and then you have the what do you need to do inside of that environment to make it run.
Exactly.
Okay, so I know this is going to run for a long time. So let's go back, and then we'll just exit out of that because I want to see a little bit about how you would actually run the model. And how do you know if these models are working or they're good or not?
Right, okay. So once your model has run, so it's going to take a while, it will go and save itself in the Azure blob storage, which is what my code is written to do. Then what we do is we go to the generate song file. And here what I'm doing is I'm loading the models from the blob storage. And once I load the models, I call the model.predict. I call the model.predict here, and I have the generated file and path where I wanted to save the produced file, which we looked at last time.
I see. So effectively what you're doing is, for the model, you're priming the pump a little bit, and then it's going to output what it thinks the next sequence of notes are going to be.
Exactly.
Okay. That's cool. So how do you know, like, I'm sure when you were running this, you ran it like a lot of times. How do you keep track of what you changed?
Right. So the experimentation service from Azure Machine Learning allows you to do that really nicely, and they have a good visualization. Also, what you can do is you can look at the list of jobs here, and it will show you, you know, what has failed and what has completed. So you have, there are some failed jobs and completed jobs, and you can look at all of your jobs there.
Well, this is amazing. So what was the hardest part of this whole project?
That's a tough question. Yep. I think the hardest part was, you know, fine-tuning the model. So you have to run a lot of experiments before it works well. And I did a lot of experiments to understand what is a good time for the input and the output, the X sequence length and Y sequence length. And I came to something that I liked, and, you know, it worked out for me.
It feels like the majority of the code was a lot of, like, getting the right numbers into the right slots for the machine learning model to understand.
Right.
Okay.
Right. And that's very important. I think with any data science and machine learning project in general, understanding your data and how it is being fed to the model is very important. Of course, the model is important itself, but understanding how that data is being fed and what are your ones and zeros mean will allow you to, you know, interpret how good or bad it is.
Fantastic. Well, thanks so much for spending some time with us. We've been learning all about the code. Sorry for to interrupt you. We've been learning all about the code behind music generation from an AI thing. Pretty excited about it. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time. Take care.
See you.